That's fine because I'm a video person. It's quite a short presentation this anyway, because I want to use this opportunity to get more feedback from everybody. So this presentation is called Making Awesome Videos, but I'm not awesome. My background is not video making, but over the last 2 years of working for TDF, I've made lots of Wing Office videos that I'm sure you've seen. So I just want to share some of the ideas and insights behind this. So yeah, you know me, Mike Saunders at TDF, working with digital marketing and also community outreach as well. So trying to get more and more people active in projects, and videos are one way to do that. Because not everybody wants to sit down and read a long blog post or, you know, read a big wiki page about getting involved. So videos are a good source of this. And we have been working hard to improve our YouTube channel. So you can see here, this is the last 12 months of views on our YouTube channel. So this time last year, at the last League Office conference, we had about just over 600,000 views. And at the end of August, we reached for the first time over 1 million views of our videos. So that was a good point to reach as well. And you can see there, it's pretty obvious when there's a new release. So that spike from January to February there, that was the LeanOffice 6.0 release. And for that, we made a video, which I'll show you again in a moment. We can look at it. So there were two types of video that we work on, broadly into kind of categories. Product videos, all about marketing LeanOffice. Yeah, to people who don't know about it, or people who are interested in it or interested in upgrading, those are purely product videos. So think of the new features videos as well, telling people, this is new, look at this, it's cool, try it out. And then we've been making lots of community videos as well. So a general Join the LeanOffice community video I made a while back, one for Documents Liberation Project as well, one for the LeanOffice conference. At the end of this conference, I'll make a wrap-up video with lots of photos and clips from interviews and clips from presentations as well. So those are not about trying to sell LeanOffice as a product, but as a project and as a community. So quite distinct types of video there, although there is a bit of overlap, as we'll see. I'll just play part of the LeanOffice 6.0 video, new features video now, which many of you may have seen anyway, so I won't play the whole thing, but this now has over 190,000 views, so that's pretty good. So, yeah, you've probably seen this before. Nice cube pattern on the background there, rather abstract, not saying anything particular. Those cubes were generated by somebody from the German community, actually, who makes German video tutorials. That's very nice. Here we have the Quark Express import feature. Very simple, just zooming in to show it. That some features are not so easy to depict, yeah, in a short space of time. Here we have the customization dialogue updates, I think done by Mohammed. The special characters dialogue that Italo just pointed out before. But you can see a plain white background there, gently zooming in. A bit of animation there, that's actually a video, not just a screenshot. The new icons as well. I forget what feature this was.
It's rotating, maybe.
Ah, yes, you can save the, when you rotate an image, you can save the original. OpenPGP, how to depict this? It's not easy. So I put a lock and I zoom in. It's not super imaginative, but maybe one of you has a better idea how to depict. It's often very, very hard to, in a short space of time, to depict technical features. You think everybody has a really short attention span on the internet. Yeah. People don't want to spend more than 3 seconds looking at something, but oh, I'm bored now. There's the help as well that we worked on. So, and then, so we start off with general features that affect all of the suites, and then we move on to specific things in Writer, so here table styles as well. And the whole video is about 4 minutes long, which I think is a reasonable time for a new features video. I think if you want to go a lot longer than that, it's best to break them up into individual videos for Writer and Calvin Impress. Because I'll show you now again the attention span of people watching videos. It does change. So here we have some statistics. These are statistics from the first 90 days of that LibreOffice 6.0 new features video. So you can see a big spike of activity at the beginning, the watch time. The average view duration, even though the video is 4 minutes long, is only 2 minutes 15 seconds. So, you know, I can take that as an insult and think, well, damn, people aren't watching the second half of the video. But that's averaging everything out, from the people who watch the whole video to the first person who's like, LibreOffice, what's that? I'm not interested. So, yeah, so this is just, again, for the first 90 days. You can see the likes we have, the dislikes, because it doesn't have a feature somebody wants, so they post a comment. You know, YouTube comments. Enough said about YouTube comments. Like, I think a couple of years ago, I think it was for April Fool's Day, April the 1st, YouTube introduced a feature when if you were posting a comment, it would read it back to you before you could post it. So the idea is people just typing the usual nonsense like, OMG, you know, no, I hate you. You'd actually play it back to them and sit with it and think, yeah, that is a really dumb thing to say. So, yeah, YouTube comments, I don't tend to interact with them that much. We have lots of positive comments, people who are, like what we do and appreciate that it's open source, but a lot of comments are like, no, dislikes, it doesn't have this feature. Like, okay, whatever. A few more statistics about this 6.0 new features video. The geographies, so US is obviously very prominent there. The gender, now we know technology tends to be more male dominated, but I don't know where YouTube gets these statistics from. Well, it's 100% male and not 1% female, so that adds up to more than 100%. But I don't think they know that information. So I would expect it to be more, slightly more male dominated, but let's just ignore that. Traffic sources, but this is very important as well, the playback locations. So this chunk, the blue chunk of people watching it on YouTube, directly on the YouTube site, but the yellow or orange or whatever, is embedded in other sites. And what Italo and I have done in press releases for the software is add this video link, and then news websites have embedded the video. So there's like Softpedia, yeah. Always embeds our video into it, into their page. Because it's good for them as well, it keeps people on their site. So we all wait, people see the video. But that's why it's a big chunk of the video viewers, especially at the start, actually the video is embedded into news websites. So that's been really important for us as well.
I suppose those embedded views, are they including your total views? We are reaching now 1 million views, that also is 28% of embedded.
Including those as well, yeah.
Okay, you can have
yeah, everything together. Because it's still YouTube sending the data, you know, it's not like the new site makes a copy of it, it's just like the frame inside. But yeah, so those numbers are included as well, yeah. Now, this is the duration of the video and how many people are still watching it through that duration. So at 0 seconds, 100% of people are watching it, you know, as you would hope. But look how quickly it drops. In the first 10 seconds, you've gone down to like 88% of your viewers. 12% of viewers just drop off in the first 10 seconds. So that's what you've got. You've got to be really, really quick in getting people's attention. There will always be a certain drop-off as well. Some people just click on things, they don't know what they're doing and the like, but yeah. So really, again, you can, as a video maker, you can look at this and think it's rather depressing. And think, well, you know, after the 2 minute mark, with only 60% of people are still watching, you know. But again, people have short attention spans. I don't take it personally. I noticed before, it goes slightly over here, or there's a little thing. And this is where we show a new icon set. So we retain people a bit longer when we show new icons. So I have to look and match the bits where it drops more quickly. Maybe this is a really boring feature. Or it looks boring, like some open PGP thing. It's not boring, it looks it, or the way I depicted it, then we get more of a people just floating. So but yeah, YouTube provides all these kind of statistics for all their videos. And yeah, this is why at the start it's really important to get people interested. You may have seen the prank that the Taiwanese community made a 30-second video about LibreOffice Android, which is really, really awesome, super active and lively, loads of Easter eggs and things. But then we made a 10-second, Franklin and his colleagues made a 10-second version that we put at the start of the LibreOffice 6.1 feature video. You may have seen that as well. So, super quick. It would be nice to have more, but really, given that people drop off quickly, we thought, got to squeeze that into 10 seconds. So it looks good, it's great branding, but yeah, anything longer and you know, people end up like, you know, where's the content, where's this? So from my experience of making videos for the last 2 years, here's my compilation of top tips. Again, I'm no expert in this, but I've learned and improved things along the way. So as mentioned, a 5 to 10 second intro maximum. If you look at lots of tech bloggers or vloggers, you know, they don't have big fancy intros or videos from other software companies as well. You know, they get really quickly into it. Tell the audience straight away what it's about. No big meandering introduction or trying to squeeze in another message. Just say, this is what you're going to see. Think again of tech bloggers unboxing a MacBook Pro or something. They're like, hey guys, I got a brand new MacBook Pro. And they say that right at the start. Make sure people know, give them a signpost. I do use background music in the new features videos. A sort of soft, generic, corporate type of music. You know, non-offensive, doesn't mean anything, but it adds something a bit more than just a voice. And I always bring this down to about 10% of the overall voice volume. So it's just there in the background as a soft kind of melody. And yeah, CC Mixter, maybe some of you have heard of this, but it's a Creative Commons music site, and it's a really, really good resource for finding this kind of generic, meaningless background music that fits a video. It doesn't distract people, it's not too exciting, not too quiet, not sad kind of, some sad piece of classical music, but something you would hear in a jazz lounge or something like that. Clear voice as well is super important. Get a good microphone and a pop filter. So the pop filter is a small circle with some kind of material in it that stops your breath from going when you're talking as well. When you're making P sounds and B sounds, these plosive sounds. If you don't have one, then just speak next to the microphone or speak like this, so you're not directly into it. But it doesn't. If you want to make videos, you don't need a super expensive microphone. My microphone, I should have brought it, is I think €20, USB microphone. I do some podcasts as well, and I use it for that. And the audio guy says it's fine. So you don't need to spend huge amounts of money on audio hardware to have pretty decent audio. But speak close to the microphone. I've heard lots of videos, seen lots of videos that are really good videos, but the person doing the voiceover sounds like they're 10 meters away, and there's lots of echo as well, so this room is an idea. So speak really, really close to the microphone. When people are listening with headphones on, they want to feel like you're in the same room, and you're speaking next to them as well. Showing features on a clean, white background, like you saw in the video before, just shows LibreOffice on the white background. I just changed the desktop wallpaper to white and then start filming or taking screenshots. And also on this topic, you may have seen in those videos, and some other people have commented, why do you have such a low resolution? Like, you know, here I have a Retina display. Why do I shrink the LibreOffice window down? Because people are watching these videos on mobile devices. I've seen some get really good LibreOffice community videos, but done on an absolutely enormous resolution, and they're trying to show a feature, and you can barely see it. You're like squinting or trying to zoom in yourself, And if they are not zooming in the video, it's difficult. So I go for a smaller LibreOffice window, but then somebody sitting in their bed with their phone on their tablet can still get something out of the video as well. So it's a bit of a trade-off. Zooming in and panning in to show specific elements, again, you've seen that in the video as well. A bit of variety, sometimes you have a static screenshot, sometimes you have some movement as well. And a call to action at the end. This is especially useful in our community videos. So don't just show what we do, but ask people to get involved. Download the software, try it out, help us as well. You know, for those 50% who make it to the end, through the, as we saw on that graph, then give them something to do at the end. Don't just stop and leave them like, you know, now what? Make them feel like this is just the beginning. There's another step as well. There's something more you can do. So that's it for my rather short presentation. You know, I didn't want to bore you with all the history of making videos and things like that, just to share my experiences and some of the tips and tricks that I've learned. But tell me, I'd like to hear from you. What do you think of the videos? What kind of videos should we make? Should we make more of a certain type of videos? Is there anything we're missing? Is there anything that's hard to localize?
No, we're currently
planning
to make videos to make videos and advertisements for brands.
For
our brands.
For the brand?
Yes. I don't want it to be in profits or someone. It's just something that I'm not telling you about the products.
So if I can say, videos about the brand then, what kind of videos could we make focusing on the brand? So we have the Document Foundation, but at the moment that's pretty much LibreOffice and the Document Liberation Project as well. I think your video is better for the brand, because the video you made for the Play Store, the Google Play Store for LibreOffice Viewer, frankly, my original idea was rather tame and rather predictable. Show some screenshots and show some features. And Franklin came on and said, well, we could do that, but let's shout about LibreOffice and show lots of other exciting things as well. And I think that video is probably more about branding, isn't it?
Yes.
Yeah.
But also.
Yeah. Yeah.
So we have a folder version
that is at LibreOffice. Then let's put it on the channel. Spreading around, yeah. Branding. Yeah. Maybe there are some more creative things we can do than just showing the software itself. So again, if anybody has ideas, then fire away. Any other thoughts or questions or comments? Any YouTube-style comments to read out?
I've been following the videos that much, but in the beginning, in order to localize the videos, you will subtitle them.
Yes.
It's now more able to have a voiceover in different languages?
Voiceovers in different languages. I can do that. If somebody sends me the audio data and sends it synced as well. Gabriele from the Italian community has done this a couple of times, because he's done audio voiceovers before. He knows about this thing. I don't have enough time to start completely editing the video again and stretching bits out. And some languages take longer to explain something than others. So German, for instance. German sentences tend to be longer than English sentences. So, that is possible. When I make a video, I can just take away the audio voiceover. And if somebody wants to send me an audio track in another language, that's great. Then I can just drop it in, but it has to match. So that's more work from your side. It really has to match. I can't start stretching bits of the video around. It simply takes way too much time. So, yeah. Normally, the current sort of workflow is, I make the video, I put the English subtitles on there, puts the English subtitles on the wiki, which then opens them for translations. And we get lots of translations. The community is fantastic. And for the 6.0 video, I think we have 19 different languages, like from all over the world. So that is brilliant. That is a great way to show that we are an international project. But even better would be voiceovers. Yeah. But I can only speak English and German with an English accent, so I'm not going to. I did make one video with me speaking German in the comments, but like, okay, where's this guy from? So, yeah.
Doch.
Any other thoughts?